عبادي وانتشت روحي وصار الدمع يجري يا إلهي خذ بقلبي للرشاد
فاشرقت نفسي بنور من فؤادي حينما رددت يا رب العباد وانتشت روحي وصار
الدمع. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وأن استغفروا ربكم ثم توبوا إليه يمتعكم متاعا حسنا إلى أجل مسمى. وقال تعالى استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا يمددكم بأموال وبنين ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم أنهارا. صدق الله العظيم. فاسيب بعض السيسترز السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله عز وجل bless her time here. May Allah Azza wa Jal make it a moment that we are able to get close to Him. Our reason of coming here and sitting here is that we find proximity to Allah Azza wa Jal. This is Friday and it's one of the Fridays in this Ramadan. We've got possibility of about, I think, and every Friday, whether it's in Ramadan or whether it's outside Ramadan, there is a moment that Allah Azza wa Jal does not reject the dua of the one who makes dua to Him. But we've got a bonus here. The bonus is that the dua that we make normally on any Friday, most of the narrations point out that time on the Friday, which starts from the Thursday Maghrib to the Friday Maghrib, that time is between Asr and Maghrib of the Friday. So it's basically from this moment all the way till the moment of Maghrib. There is, according to many narrations, this is the time. Some narrations say it's around the Jummah time, some narrations say it's in the night time beforehand and so on, but there's about 45 narrations saying it's from the Asr time all the way to Maghrib time. Now, if you want something, as I mean serious about this, if you want something from right now, ask. Don't stop asking. From right now, ask. And don't stop asking until the Maghrib Adhan goes. Right now, start asking Allah for something you need, really need. And while I'm carrying doing the lecture, you carry on asking Allah Azza wa Jal. And don't stop asking Allah Azza wa Jal until Maghrib Adhan is heard. Because if this is the sa'a la yuraddu fiha al-du'a, if this is the time in which the du'a is not rejected, then you will attain what you're supposed to attain. On top of that, the bonus here is that it's in Ramadan. It's in Ramadan. And being in Ramadan, every evening of Ramadan, Allah Azza wa Jal, He accepts our du'as. Every evening before the iftar, Allah accepts our du'as. So you got that as an extra bonus feature. Extra bonus feature that you make is du'a. Allah Azza wa Jal will not reject the du'a. Now in saying that, what I want to do is I want to say a few things about du'a. Because it's very important that we understand what dua is. According to a hadith in Abu Dawood, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, "Ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah." Dua is worship. Now why did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say dua is worship? You look at any worship we do, without dua there is no worship. Without dua there is no worship. Salah, we have got dua inside there. Right at the end of Salah, Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi dhulman kathira. Or right at the end of Salah, Rabbi ja'alni muqeem wa salati, Rabbana atina fid dunya hasana, and so on. Inside the Salah itself, There are several times when we are making a request to Allah Azza wa Jal. سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ Meaning that Allah has accepted. We are asking Allah, Allah accept this dua, accept this salah of ours. If you look at fasting, you open the fast with a dua. You close the fast with a dua. And during the iftar time, just before the iftar time, you make dua. At suhoor time, you make dua. These are the etiquettes of fasting. You look at a person who's going to Hajj. The whole of Hajj, in every single part he's going, he's making dua. You look at the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he just built the Kaaba. He just building the Kaaba or built the Kaaba. And as he had just finished it, he said, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ تَسْتَمِعُ الْعَلِيمُ That dua is recorded in Surah Baqarah. You find the Anbiya, they are in need of Allah Azza wa Jal, they turn to Allah in dua. When they're in trouble, they turn to Allah for dua. Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam said, Rabbi inni maghlubun fantasir. Oh Allah, I have been overcome, so I'm asking for your help. When they wanted to ask Allah, in fact, a beautiful one of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam is what? And many of us have forgotten this sunnah of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, which Allah taught us in the Quran, so that this may be alive until the day of judgment. When Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam made this dua, Rabbi inni maghlubun fantasir. Oh Allah, I am overcome by these people, so I'm asking for your help. He made a lengthy dua. And in that dua, what he did is he made his talab, or what he was asking for, was right at the end. But before that, Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam did one thing which me and you do as friends. You know, when you have a trouble, you sit with a friend and you say, did you hear what happened to me? And your friend says, what happened to you? You say, well, I went to work today. And you know that guy I told you about? Well, yeah. That guy today, Allahu Akbar, when I walked in, I got the dirty looks. And when I went in the office and I sat down, he was watching what time I had walked in, so he was going to grasp me up to the boss. And I sat down and I started doing my work, then he was walking over nearby to see, look at me, to look over to see what work I was doing. Can you believe it? You know, this guy wants to kick me out of this job. You know, he wants to get rid of him. And did you hear what happened after that? What happened after that? He said, at lunchtime, the guy, when I left for lunch, he came to my desk to see how much work I had done. And blah, 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 I'm just giving you an example. Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, he does the same thing with Allah Azza wa Jal. How? He starts to ask Allah, he says to Allah, before he even says what kind of help he needs from Allah, he says, Rabbi inni da'utu qawmi laylan wa nahara. Oh Allah, I asked these people by night and by day. Oh Allah, did you see that I went to them by night time? Oh Allah, I went to them by daytime. And I said to them, I said these words, istaghfiru rabbakum. I said to them that you should seek forgiveness from your Lord. Every time I asked them, oh Allah, they covered their faces and they put their fingers in their ears and they asarru wastakbaru istighbara. They were very stubborn and they became even more arrogant in their ways. Oh Allah, I called them in secrecy, sirran wa jahra, I called them in openness. Why did Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam have to say this to Allah Azza wa Jal that sees everything? Because Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam is seeing Allah as a wali, as a guardian. And Allahu waliyyu alladhina amanu, Allah is the guardian of those who believe in him. And Allah is the close one and the master of those. As a servant to a master, he is putting forth his way, just like two friends. We are two friends, we say, did you see that guy, did that, did you see? And then that happened, and then that happened. Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam is doing this. This is a wonderful way of relieving stress. You know, a lot of people who have stress, a lot of people who have problems, they often pick up the phone and they will say to their, you know, whoever it is, did you hear what happened? Shall I tell you the latest of what's happening in my life? And then she says, yes. So you say, okay, get ready for episode number 42. You know, this is what's happening in my life of EastEnders. Right? I'm in the middle of it. And can you believe this person did that, and that person did that, and I said this, and what do you advise me to do right now? Or did you hear what? And a whole part of the gossip is what actually happened. And a lot of us do this. You do it in the masjid when you come sit with people, you do it when you're outside the masjid, you do it when you see your friends outside. Women do it a lot of the times, you know, when they see one another over the phone or whatever. A lot of that with their husbands as well, the husbands do it with their wives. But Allah Azza wa Jal is asking this one thing, which is what? You want to relieve your stress? Come and talk to me. Come and talk to me. Because I know not only your enemies, I know your whole history of your enemies. I'm the one who created your enemies. I have the cells in my hands. I have the neurons in my hands. I have the breathing is in my hands. Their eating is in my hands. The risk is in my hands. The provision is in my hands. I am the provider. I am the Lord. I am the sustainer. And I can do what I want. I even know the entire future as well. Allahu Akbar. So you want to come and you want to talk to anyone to relieve your stress. Who better to relieve one's stress than to go to Allah Azza wa Jalla? And you just put your hands up. And this is one of the ways of getting stress relieved. Because you need to talk to someone. Or who better to talk to than Allah Azza wa Jalla? So Allah Azza wa Jalla, his messengers, as I'm saying, they used to talk to him. And they used to say, this is what happened. And Allah, I'm in this situation. So when we're in trouble, we take the examples of the Anbiya. When we need something, when we need something extra, like Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam said, رَبَّنَا أَنْزِلْ عَلَيْنَا مَائِدَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. If you've got hope in something, you can make a dua for something extra that you don't even have. And it is out of our, you know, hope that we will receive that. Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam, he made this dua, he said, رَبِّ هَبْلِي مُلْكَ لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِنْ بَعْدِي. Allah, give me, oh Lord, grant me such a kingdom that no one after me will have. So we can make these du'as for extra things that we want to get. But one thing which is crucial is that Allah's most beloved servants are the Anbiya. And out of all the servants, every single servant, Allah Azza wa Jal has described the whole scenario of how they make du'a. He didn't just say the du'a. He made the whole scenario. Subhanallah al-Azim. Because Allah loved it so much. Allah wants to teach us what situations they need dua. So He talks about His rahmah, His mercy that He gave to His servant Zakariya alayhi salam. But to say all of that, He mentions the scenario. So He says the scenario is, إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ نِدَاءً خَفِيًّا. This is my servant Zakariya, but this servant Zakariya is calling me نِدَاءً خَفِيًّا. He's calling me long callings. Is nida, is the difference between nida and dua. Dua is that you just call, you just say what you actually want. You ask what you want. Nida is when you do it with a slight, you do it by yearning. You have this yearning inside you. You have this cry inside the call. When you have a slight cry inside the call, it's nada, nida. إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ نِدَاءً خَفِيًّا. He was calling me in the night time and he was calling me in secrecy. Allah mentioned another quality. Secretly he was calling me. He didn't want anyone in his whole time to know that he was calling me. But I loved his calling so much that I've revealed it in the Holy Quran that until the day of judgment, the whole of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will get to know about this secret calling that my servant Zakariya alayhi wa sallam used to call. نِدَاءً خَفِيًّا. This secret calling, no one knows. Allah loves us so much that He mentioned it in the Quran. And He mentioned, you know, He didn't have to say nida'an khafiyya. He didn't have to say this long, yearning, secret call of Zakariya alayhi salam. But these are the things He loves. So He said that. Then what did Allah say after that? إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ نِدَاءً خَفِيًّا قَالَ رَبِّي إِنِّي وَهَنَ الْعَظْمُ مِنِّي. Oh my Lord, my bones have become weak. My bones are very frail and they're weak. وَاشْتَعَلَ الرَّأْسُ شَيْبًا. My whole hair has inflamed in whiteness. My whole hair, all from one end to another end, is white. I've got not a single black hair on my head. My bones, they're weak and I'm frail at this moment. وَلَمْ أَكُمْ بِدُعَائِكَ رَبِّ شَقِيًّا. But even though this is my situation, I haven't lost the hope that you're going to answer my dua. I haven't lost that hope. Because an old man who's this old will never have the hope of having a child. But I, at this age, I still haven't lost the hope that you'll give me a child. And he says what? After explaining his own situation, he says, ولم أكن بدعائك رب شقيا. He says that after that, وكانت امرأتي عاقرة. He says, my wife, she's also barren. So she can't actually give birth to a child. وقد بلغت من الكبر عتيا. I've reached such an old age of life that, you know, a man like me shouldn't really be here making dua. But you know what? I'm still going to make that dua to you. Allah loved all of this. He mentioned all of this. Why? Because Allah wanted to show us that, you know, hope doesn't matter if you have 100% wall in front of you, you got nowhere out. Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't see a dead end. There's no dead end with Allah. Allah can give whoever He wants to give. And this is the beginning of, Allah hasn't even mentioned His dua yet. He's mentioning His condition. Why does Allah do that? Because it's a massive lesson to us to understand. For dua, you don't need to see possibility in possibility. You just look at me. If you want the impossible to become possible, I will do that to you. And I can do that. But I need your faith. Zakaria didn't do this on one night. He did this on many, many, many different nights. And it so happens that the whole context again is explaining Surah Maryam, how he used to give, come and see Maryam, and one day he comes and sees that she's got fruits of a different season inside her chamber. When the chamber was locked, the only person with the key was Zakaria alayhi salam. No one came in, no one went out. Maryam alayhi salam was inside, and he comes and he sees fruits of a different season with her. And he says, what? قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمُ أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا. Oh Maryam, how did you get this? And she says, قَالَتْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. It is only Allah. Allah gave me these fruits while I'm sitting here. I had no fruit. Allah gave it to me, and such fruits that you cannot even find in this whole country. They're out of the season. And when Zakaria saw that, he thought, this chamber, this place is Mubarak. This place is blessed. هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَا رَبَّهُ. Why did Allah have to say هُنَالِكَ? Because Zakaria alayhi salam knew that this is the place of barakah. There are certain places that Allah has blessed. If you make dua, those blessed places, Allah will accept the dua. The Kaaba is blessed. Muzdalifah is blessed. You find Arafah is blessed on the day of Arafah. In front of the Hatim, that place, Maqam Ibrahim is blessed. You find the day of Arafah itself across the world is blessed as a time. The masjid is blessed. The masjid is blessed. So the places where Allah Azza wa Jal accepts somebody, He gives a gift to someone, a miracle, if you make the dua, then you will be accepted. That's why Allah said, هُنَالِكْ. In that place, دَعَى زَكَرِيَّا رَبَّهُ. Zakaria alayhi salam started to do two rakat straight away, and in his dua, he started to make dua. And straight away Allah Azza wa Jal, in his salah, said, يَا زَكَرِيَّا إِنَّا نُبَشِّرُكَ بِغُلَامٍ. Oh Zakaria, and now I'm giving you good news of a child who is Yahya. Now why did Allah Azza wa Jalla have to tell us the entire context of this? Why? Because every part of your dua, you know, when you make dua, when I make dua, when I make it and I say, oh Allah, oh Allah, oh Allah, and I repeat it three times, Allah loves that. That's why Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he made dua, kana yad'u thalathan. He sometimes used to repeat it three times. Allah loves that. You repeat it, Allah loves that. The fact that you are begging Allah, Allah loves that. فَأَلِحْهُ فِي الدُّعَى. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in one hadith, he said, be like beggars in your dua, that you continuously ask and you ask and you ask again in your dua. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us he liked that. Even when a person, he's making dua, okay, he's making dua. You know, some of us, we make dua and we can't feel emotion. We can't feel emotion. So we make dua. So some of us might think, okay, I'm just going to make dua like this. I'm not emotional at all. And others want to try and cry. They can't cry. So they try and make a face like they want to cry. You know, this Allah loves. There's no tears. There's no emotion inside you. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِن لَمْ تَبْكُوا فَتَبَاكُوا. He said, if you cannot cry, then start to pretend to cry. SubhanAllah. Start to pretend. Make a pretending face in front of Allah to cry. Allah loves that. That's why it's in the sunnah of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he's told his sahaba and he's told us as well through them that you pretend to cry. It's not nifaq. It's not hypocrisy. It's that you wanted to cry. You couldn't cry, so you went halfway there. You start to make a face. however you can, to show Allah that if I could have cried, I would have loved to cry, but I couldn't cry, but here I am. I'm asking you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told all of this for a reason. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He likes it when we do this in front of Him. An angel asked Allah Azza wa Jal, according to one hadith, "Oh Allah, this servant of yours has asked you this thing again and again and again and again. Allah, you still haven't granted this person this thing. You still haven't granted this person this thing." Now imagine, it's been months you've been asking for one dua and you never got it. Your dua most likely is getting even more and more serious. And you're using all kind of words to ask Allah. What did Allah say to that angel? Allah Azza wa Jal said, "Oh my angel, yes I know my servant has been asking you for such a long time. But you know when he asks me in this manner and he prolongs his call towards me, I love it every time he gets up at that this time of the day or this time of the 24 hours. I love that he calls me. And my angel, once I grant it to my servant is not going to be there anymore to ask me like this. And because I love this call of my servant, I am holding back giving it to my servant because his call is more beloved than the fact that I give him this thing. The fact that he's calling me, the fact that he cries to me every day, the fact that he shows me that he's in need of me every day, the fact that he shows me this yearning, this heart that he's got reaching out towards me, that Allah Azza wa Jal likes more than the fact that we would actually have this dua accepted and he gifts us. Now some of us might think that my dua wasn't accepted. I made this dua, it wasn't accepted. Don't think in that manner, because Allah Azza wa Jal, He has, according to one hadith, this is a sahih hadith in Imam Ahmad's kitab. Bazar has related this, Abu Ya'la has related this, all of them with good chains. Hakim has also related this, and he has said sahih with isnad, this is a sahih hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "Ma min muslimin yad'u bidawa laysa fiha ithm wa la qati'atu rahim illa a'taahu Allah biha ihda thalath." There is no Muslim that makes a dua. Not a single Muslim in the world, they make a dua to Allah Azza wa Jal in which there is no sin and there is also nothing where they're asking Allah to break their ties. Allah doesn't like it when we make dua for a sin, a sinful thing or something which is haram for us. So as long as these things are not inside there, Allah Azza wa Jal will give them one of three. Imma an yu'ajjila lahu da'wata. Either Allah will straight away accept your dua and give you what you actually ask for. وَإِمَّا أَنْ يَدَّخِرَهَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. Or Allah Azza wa Jal will store it for the Akhirah. So He didn't give it to you in this world, but Allah Azza wa Jal stored it as reward that you got in return of your dua for the Akhirah. وَإِمَّا أَنْ يَصْرِفَ عَنْهُ مِنَ السُّوءِ مِثْلَهَا. Or Allah Azza wa Jal will not give you that thing you asked for, or He will give you something else in return. So you're asking Allah to save you from a calamity. He might not have saved you from that calamity, but He will save you from something which is similar to that. قَالُوا إِذَا نُكْثِرُ قَالَ اللَّهُ أَكْثَرُ. They said, "Messenger of Allah, if this is the case, that Allah gives us one of these three things, then we're going to increase our du'as to Allah." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in that case, Allah will increase the thing that He will give you. Allah will increase the thing that He's given you. Now imagine, this is one hadith. In another hadith, according to Hakim, the person, he will reach the Akhirah. فَإِذَا عُجِّلَ لِلْعَبْدِ دُعَاءُهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَرَآ مَا اتُّخِرَ لِغَيْرِهِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. When a person will come on the Day of Judgment and he's going to see that Allah accepted this dua for me, He accepted that dua, He gave all of these different duas. And there's another person there whom Allah, He didn't accept his duas, many of his duas, but He gave him these things in Jannah in return. So he never got his duas answered, but he got something else in return in Jannah. When a person will see all those things that he got in Jannah, for the du'as that weren't accepted in his lifetime, in return of those du'as that weren't accepted in his lifetime, this person will say, يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ يُعَدَّلْ لِي شَيْءٍ مِّن دُعَاءِ فِي الدُّنْيَا. The person will say, if only all my du'as were rejected from the du'as I made in the world and I got return, in return of that, I got something in Jannah. The person will wish that all of his du'as would have been rejected, none of them would have been accepted, because he knows today, on the day of Akhirah, he sees now that in return of the du'as that are not accepted, you get greater things in Jannah that you couldn't even get by doing your ibadah. So this person is even more, he wished that his du'as wouldn't have been accepted in the dunya. You can imagine that we are those, you know, of course in this world we want some of our, and many of our du'as, we want them to be accepted, but don't think that we are losers. We never lose. A mu'min, a believer, never loses when he comes to Allah Azza wa Jalla with the du'a, as long as the du'a hasn't got anything that is sinful inside. Now, Allah Azza wa Jalla, His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, according to hadith in Hakim, Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi, both have also narrated this, they have said it's with a good chain, and Ibn Majah, Ibn Hibban had narrated this, Ibn Hibban said that this is Sahih hadith, and so has Hakim done the same thing. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says about Allah, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيٌّ كَرِيمٌ يَسْتَحْيِي إِذَا رَفَعَ الْعَبْدُ إِلَيْهِ يَدَيْهِ أَنْ يَرُدَّهُمَا صِفْرًا خَائِبَتَيْنِ. Allah Azza wa Jal is, Allah Azza wa Jal finds it just like me and you, when a beggar comes to us and a beggar has been asking us, sometimes, you know, you feel like, how can I just let this guy go without anything in his hand? Sometimes you just take some pocket change or anything you can, you give it to the person so that he doesn't go away from you empty-handed. Allah Azza wa Jal is very noble, and Allah Azza wa Jal shows the same quality, that He is in a sense morally embarrassed. It's not because Allah Azza wa Jal needs to get embarrassed, but out of the fact that His servant has put his hands towards Him, that Allah would send you away empty-handed without receiving anything from Him, Allah would do that. Allah Azza wa Jal is morally embarrassed, so He will make sure that you return with something. That is why when we make dua by raising our hands. And raising our hands, you know, some people, it's not good to just close all the hands. Don't close all the hands for dua. Because we are asking Allah to put something inside you. You're asking Allah, that's one of the adabs of dua. You ask now, it's good to keep the two hands close, and it's good to keep them like a beggar, that is close together, so that if the one you're begging from gives you something, it's going to go in your hand, and it wouldn't basically drop inside. Yes, it's fine, it's jais, it's completely allowed for you to, you know, keep a gap in between, it's completely allowed, right? But the more of a begging situation a person is, the more better it is for you to, or more likely it is that your dua will get accepted. You know, some people, they make dua, they're like this. They got their hands right here. Now, how much of a beggar is that you've got your hands right next to your belly, and you've got them tucked inside you, and you're making dua? I mean, you don't have to put your hands up. But if you're going to put your hands up for a dua, it's better that you show that you're making dua in your begging situation. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had three different sunnahs. One was that he put his hands together and he would put them, he would bring them up to his chest level. His hands up to his chest level. Another one that he would put his hands together and he would move it up to his face level. Another one is, his sunnah is that he would put both of his hands, his arms, he would stretch them up to the sky and he would put them way over his head. This is the third sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he was very desperate, he would do that. Another sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is, you want to be in a begging situation, is that you make the dua inside your sujood. You make your dua inside the sujood. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِذَا فَزِعَهُ الْأَمْرُ, when he used to get something that would trouble him, he straight away would make two rakats salah. That would be two rakats specifically because he was terrified by something. And he would be terrified by something, he would make two rakat salah. This is sunnah, that is a forgotten sunnah. A lot of people, when they get terrified, they want to go and, you know, look for help with someone. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam straight away look for help from Allah Azza wa Jalla. And these two rakats, sometimes what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do is that he would prolong his sajda. And in his sajda, he would ask Allah Azza wa Jal to remove this trouble. Sometimes he would come inside the masjid and he would go straight into the sujood. Allahu Akbar, straight into sujood. This sujood was of different kinds. Sometimes it was sajda to shukr. Sometimes he would just thank Allah and go into sujood. And sometimes when he needed something, he would go into sujood as well. So if somebody wants to do that, revive that sunnah, you can do that as well. But if a person is doing a salat, then you cannot say anything but Arabic inside your salat. But if a person is doing a sajda on its own, just a sajda on its own, then you can make whichever language you want, you can make a dua in that. So please remember this, I'm not saying in any salat. Any salat there is, whether it's two rakats, four rakats, whatever it is, you cannot make any dua except in Arabic. But if you're making a sajda on its own, so there's no salah, you didn't start off with a salah, you just went straight into sujood, in that you can make dua in any language you want. So if one of us wants to, we can make a dua inside the sujood, because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam referred to a hadith in Bukhari, he said, فَقَمِنٌ أَن يُسْتَجَابُ لَكُمْ. He said that it's likely that your du'as will be accepted while you're actually in the sujood. Now, we're going to make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. Now, in making dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, there are certain adabs and etiquettes. There are certain adabs and there are certain etiquettes. And there are certain ways of unlocking the secrets of the unseen if you know how to do certain little things. One of the things I've just told you is making dua between Asr and Maghrib. Even on a normal day, it's good to make dua between Asr and Maghrib, that your dua gets accepted. On a Friday, it's even more closer that your dua will be accepted. On this day, it's even more likely. So one of the things is to know the zaman, to know the time. Another one is to know the makan, the place. If you know the places where dua is accepted, it's likely that it will be accepted. Another one is if you give some sadaqah before you give your dua, make your dua. In a certain ahadith, it says that when you've given a sadaqah, then it's likely that your dua will be accepted. Another one is that you make istighfar. You start seeking forgiveness from Allah first, because according to our predecessors, they looked into the Quran and they found that istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Allah, making tawbah to Allah, these are two prerequisites to a dua being accepted. And they took from Surah Hud the ayah number. If you look in Surah Hud, ayah number 10, or if you look in Surah Nuh, ayah number 11, so on, you will find that Allah Azza wa Jal, sorry, in Surah Hud, it's in a couple of different places. In Surah Hud, it's right at the beginning of Surah Hud, and Surah Nuh, you'll find it part of the way inside. It says, وَأَنِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ يُمَتِّعُكُمْ مَتَاعًا حَسَنًا. In another part of Surah Hud, it says, يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا. Oh my people, start to seek forgiveness from Allah. This is Sayyidina Hud alayhi salam saying it to his people. Oh my people, seek forgiveness from Allah. Tubu ilayhi, return back to Allah. You see this sama'a alaykum midrara. You know these skies that have stopped raining above you, they will start to rain once again onto you. The rains will open because of your istighfar. So you're asking for dua, you're asking your Lord for the rains to come. It will not happen until you make istighfar and you make tawbah. Sayyidina Ali al-Khawas, who was one of the great leading pious predecessors, he said that مَا تَوَقَّفَ عَنْ أَحَدٍ حَاجَةٍ مِنْ حَوَائِجِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ إِلَّا مِنْ تَرْكِهِ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ. He says, because people have left seeking forgiveness from Allah, this is one of the reasons why Allah has stopped giving them certain gifts that Allah was going to give to them. So if you want to release those gifts, one of the things is to seek forgiveness from Allah. So before you do your dua, start to say istighfar. Astaghfirullah, inna Allah ghafoor rahim. Astaghfirullah, inna Allah ghafoor rahim. Astaghfirullah, alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum wa atubu ilayhi. This particular istighfar, Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum wa atubu ilayh. There are certain ahadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
Here said in the hadith in okay, there are different types of hadith. I'll find that particular hadith and I'll quote it to you. But this hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in Hakim, it is narrated up to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من قال اللهم مغفرتك أوسع من ذنوبي ورحمتك أرجى عندي من عملي ثلاث مرات غفر الله له. If a person says that اللهم مغفرتك أو الله your forgiveness أوسع من ذنوبي is a lot more vast than the sin that I've committed. ورحمتك أرجى عندي your mercy is more hopeful. I'm more hopeful of receiving your mercy than having hope of my actions saving me or gaining me anything. I'm more hopeful that I will get something through your mercy. If somebody says this dua 3 times, Allahumma maghfiratuka awsa' min dhunubi wa rahmatuka arja 'indi min 'amali, if somebody says that 3 times, then Allah would have forgiven that person. There's also in hadith where a person makes 2 rakats specifically. This is a hadith in Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Ibn Hibban, in his Sahih collection. He has said, there's no servant of Allah. He has committed a sin. فَيُحْسِنُ الطُّهُورِ He makes a good wudu. ثُمَّ يَقُومُ فَيُصَلِّ Then a person stands up and he makes 2 rakats. يُصَلِّ رَكَعَتَيْنِ ثُمَّ يَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ Then after his 2 rakats, he makes istighfar. He starts to seek forgiveness from Allah Azza wa Jal. إِلَّا غُفِرَ لَهِ Except that Allah Azza wa Jal would have forgiven this person. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam he quoted the verse from Surah Ali Imran, 135th verse. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا Those people who do some actions of obscenity and so on. أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ Or they have oppressed themselves. ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ They remember Allah and Allah Azza wa Jal, He then forgives them. So this is a particular istighfar or method of istighfar to do. In the dua, if a person does that, where they say, أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْحَيِّ الْقَيُّمُ The names of Allah, Al-Hayy and Al-Qayyum. In the istighfar is very powerful to have those two names there, وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ at the end. أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْحَيِّ الْقَيُّمُ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ And also, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard certain sahaba, they making dua. One particular sahabi, when he heard him making dua, and he started to say the words, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum. When he started to say the words, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, or he said, for example, he heard one particular servant, one particular servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said, Ya Dhal Jalali Wal Ikram, O one of awe-inspiring qualities, Wal ikram, O one who loves, one who is full of gifting his servants. He started saying these words, Ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard that, he said, Faqad istujiba lak, fasal. Allah has now accepted your dua, now continue to ask from Allah Azza wa Jal. Another person, he said, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed by Abu Ayyash, and he was praying, he said, Allahumma inni as'aluka bi anna laka alhamd. لا إله إلا أنت يا منان يا بديع السماوات والأرض يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. This is a Sahih hadith in Ibn Hibban, also narrated in Abu Dawood and Nasai and so on. But this person said, اللهم إني أسألك أو الله I am asking you بأن لك الحمد for you there is praise. لا إله إلا أنت there is no one except for yourself as a worthy of worship. يا منان one who gifts his servants without his servant having to ask him. Ya badi'a as-samawati wal-ard, O originator of the heavens and the earth. Ya dhal jalali wal-ikram. When he made this dua, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commented on his dua. There's in one riwayah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard, Ya hayyu ya qayyum. When he's heard this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Laqad sa'alta Allah bismihi al-azam. You have asked Allah with his greatest name. With his most greatest name, الَّذِي إِذَا دُعِيَ بِهِ أَجَابْ When Allah is asked with the words, يَا حَيُّ يَا قَيُّمْ Allah does not refuse that dua. وَإِذَا سُئِلَ بِهِ أَعْطَى When a person will make such a dua, Allah will grant him that thing and he will give it to him. So these are some of the words which a person can say to Allah Azza wa Jal when making a dua. In the beginning, you praise Allah Azza wa Jal. You praise Him in making the dua. This is the first thing that you do when you make the dua. You start to praise Allah Azza wa Jal. That's why when we start our salah, the first thing we say is Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Why? We are opening the prayer with an actual praise itself. So you can praise Allah Azza wa Jal. One great way of praising Allah is to read the 99 names. A lot of ulama have said that reading the 99 names and saying each one, one by one, and in the end, then making the dua, then starting dua, is a very powerful way of getting the dua answered. So you say, you start and you say, Ya Allahu, Ya Rahmanu, and Ya Rahimu, and so on. And in saying this, you can choose your own tune and your tone of how you want to say to Allah. Even the tune and the tone can be something which Allah loves. You know, there are ulama in the past that have used many different ways of asking Allah Azza wa Jal. If you listen to the awliya and those who are close to Allah Azza wa Jal, they have got specific tunes to call Allah Azza wa Jal.
Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Malik, Ya Quddus, Ya Salam.
Can choose whatever. I'm not saying that you have to choose this specific one. You can choose the other ones. I've heard other ulama.
Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Malik, Ya Quddus, Ya Salam, Ya Rahim,
and so on. Or you can choose one that will make you cry as you're asking the 99 names of Allah. It's a good way of starting the dua. When a person has started the dua and they've asked Allah Azza wa Jal, they're going to get into part of asking Allah, the best and first and foremost thing the person should try and start is from the du'as of the Qur'an and then the du'as of the Sunnah. And you will see one thing in the du'as of the Qur'an, there is the word Rabbana. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He has loved this. When a person acknowledges Allah is the sustainer, He's the one that has kept him going, He's the provider, all these meanings are in the word Rabb. That is why Allah loves the person says, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ and so on and so forth. The du'as of Rabbana, you can find them in specific books. You can find them in specific books. And you can use them to call Allah Azza wa Jal. Then use the adhiya ma'thura. These are known as the ones that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has used in his sunnah. And there are certain books that you can buy. The Hisnul Muslim has got many of these du'as inside there. The fortress of the Muslim. Or you can find in Hizb al-Azam, you can find there. There's a book in there, there are many different du'as, collection of many du'as of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Or any other du'a book that you find, there are plenty of du'as from those of Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the best thing is, if you cannot remember any of them, the one Sahabi, he came to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made a wonderful du'a. And the Sahabi, he said, Messenger of Allah, if only I could remember all these words that you said, I'm not going to remember these words that you said. They're such beautiful du'as. So Prophet ﷺ then said, should I not teach you a dua, that if you say this one dua, you will get all the things that I asked for? And if I teach you a dua, then you will be saved from all the things that I sought refuge from? So he said, yes, Messenger of Allah. So Prophet ﷺ said, he said, say this, Allahumma inni as'aluka jami'a ma sa'ala minhu nabiyyuk Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, I am asking you, inni as'aluka, I am asking you, Jami'a, every single thing, ma sa'alaka, of all those things which your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has asked you, ma sa'alaka nabiyyuk Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa a'udhu bika, and I seek refuge in you, min jami'i, from all those things, min jami'i, masta'adaka, all those things that your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sought refuge in you from those things, I am asking you refuge from all those things, from all the same things. جَمِيعَ مَسْتَعَاذَكَ مِنْهُ نَبِيُّكُ مُحَمَّدْ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And in that you can add, وَأَنْتَ الْمُسْتَعَانِ. And you are the one of all the favors and gifts. You are the one that is sought for protection. البلاغ. And you are the one that conveys, وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ الْعَظِيمِ. There is no one to avert me from any of the calamities that lie ahead of me, and no one to grant me
or has the power to give me those things that I want. وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ except through you, Allah Azza wa Jal. You hold all the powers that exist. إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ الْعَظِيمِ. So when a person says this, a person makes this dua, it is likely that you will get all the things that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made. Sometimes, you know when iftar is getting very close, or suhoor is very close to end, and you got no other dua, just make this dua. It's a very simple way of getting all the things that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has asked for, and you get everything in one short dua. So you can say this dua. And it's good for us to learn the Arabic. If you can learn the Arabic, we should keep this thing alive. But you know what the best dua is? The best dua, if you can't think of the Arabic or the Arabic is too much, you can't even make sense of it in your head, please don't worry. Just make dua in your mother tongue. The best dua is the one that comes from your heart. And that is in your first language or with your mother tongue. Our ustad used to say this again and again. When you want to ask from Allah, Allah doesn't have any barriers of languages. It doesn't mean that if you didn't ask him in Arabic, it's like he's a reject. Sorry, go learn Arabic first. Allah doesn't have such a rule. You can ask Allah Azza wa Jalla in whichever language you want, and you can ask Him without even, you know, there's one hadith that says, "Man shaghala dhikri an mas'alati." It's a beautiful hadith. Whosoever is so occupied with my dhikr and my remembrance, whoever is so occupied with my dhikr and my remembrance, that they don't even get the time to even ask me, أَعْطَيْتُهُ أَكْثَرَ مِمَّا أُعْتِي السَّائِلِينَ. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in this hadith of Qudsi, He says, when this happens that my servant, he's so occupied in my dhikr and my remembrance, he doesn't even have the time to ask me, or he's not asking me, but he's just in my dhikr. I give more to him than I give to those who ask me in dua. I give more to him. And there's a hadith that is very similar to this. Man lazim al istighfar. Whosoever will continuously make istighfar to Allah Azza wa Jal, ja'ala lahu, Allah will make for that particular person, ja'ala Allahu lahu min kulli hammin faraja, wa min kulli dhiqin makhraja, wa razaqahu min haythu la yahtasib. This hadith, though some have said that there's certain weakness, but others, one particular muhaddith has said, because Imam Bukhari has mentioned this in his Adab al-Mufrad, and he hasn't actually commented on the chain of narration, that means it's acceptable. That whosoever, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whosoever will continuously seek forgiveness from Allah, Allah will do these things for him. Allah will, ja'ala Allahu lahu min kulli hammin faraja. Allah will make open for them a way out from every single stress and difficulty they face. وَمِن كُلِّ ضِيقٍ مَخْرَجًا. Every single thing that they have a dead end and they can't get out, Allah will open for them a way out. وَرَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِدْ. And Allah will grant them from His provisions in a way that you can't even comprehend. This is one thing with istighfar, the other one is with salutation from the Prophet ﷺ. The first thing of dua is to open it with salutations on the Messenger ﷺ. And the last thing is to again end it with salutations on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's many ahadith where it signifies that by sending salutations on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the end, in the middle, beginning and end of the dua, it is likely that the things that you have said in between, they won't be rejected. So that's another way of getting the dua accepted. And when we make the dua, we make dua for ourselves. I said this last time, I'm just going to quickly, very quickly go over this. You make dua for yourself. You make dua, go from the most closest to the furthest. Okay? So you think about yourself. Ask for yourself. And everything you can ask for yourself. And then ask for your close ones. Who are your close ones? The first close ones is who? Are your parents. Ask for your parents. Don't forget them. Ask for now when you think about your parents, just quickly ask all your uncles and aunts and those grandfathers, grandmothers, whoever's related to them. Ask for them, because they came before you and they looked after you. So they have a right over you and anyone else after them. Then you ask for your brothers and sisters, they're close to you. Ask for your children, ask for your wife, ask for your husband, whatever. Ask for the close ones. When you've done all your close ones, then ask for your next close ones, which are your friends, your colleagues, those of them who are close to you. Make dua for them, because there's an angel that is standing right behind you making dua for you each time you make dua for them. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us about this.
Then when you make that, then start asking for your dunya and asking for your akhirah. So in terms of the dunya, start asking all the things you want here. Start from, if some people say, well, how long dua I want to make? Ya, akhi, you are stuck for a dua. Your daughter's only 3 years old. Make dua right now that she finds a pious husband. Start today. Seriously, start today. We're wasting time. How do you know that you're going to be alive when she gets married to make this dua? Tell me. How do you know you're going to be allowed to make this dua? So you make dua now, you make dua for their ilm, for their knowledge, for their amal, for their good action, for their risk, for their provision, for their future, for their education, for their good grades, for their good jobs, for their good spouses. You make that from now, even though they're young. You make it now. Why? Because you look in the Quran, when Sayyidina Khidr alayhi salam and Sayyidina Musa, they were basically traveling. The third travel was what? They came across this wall that was going to fall. Underneath the wall was treasures belonging to two orphans. And because of their pious father's dua, Allah sent Khidr at that time to mend the wall. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا Allah said that. Their pious father made dua for these orphans and that passed away. He passed away. But Allah Azza wa Jalla heard his dua while he was alive. He made dua when his children were young. And Allah Azza wa Jalla accepted it when he was gone. His children were still here. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he sent Khidr to mend the wall. So you don't know which dua will reach where. So make that dua right now. So you make dua for your dunya, you make dua for your akhirah. When you start with the akhirah, go through every single manzil. Go through the death. Say, oh Allah, I want my death like this. I want my grave to be like this. I want my when I come up on the day of judgment, I want it to be like this. And when I basically go through, when I get my book, I want you to do like this. And when I want to be under your arsh and make me one of the categories. And I want to go through on the bridge without having to touch it and so on. Mention all of that. Mention hellfire. Mention the description of a hellfire. Say, oh Allah, save me from this of a hellfire. Save me from the fire of hell, from the scorpions of hell, from the hooks of hell, from the angels of hellfire. Then mention Jannah. All the things you want in Jannah, all the things you can get. Then if you got time still, go through the whole of your world politically as well. Politically, don't forget all the Muslims that are across the world who are asking for Allah's help. Situation that needs to change on the earth. Make dua for them. Make dua for the Muslims that are here right now. Make dua for these. And please don't forget. Don't just make dua for Muslims only. Please, my brothers, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is that he made dua for the lot of the non-Muslims that are around him. He made dua for his worst of his enemies. How do you think Umar ibn Khattab came into the deen? How do you think Umar ibn Khattab came into the deen? It was the dua of the Prophet ﷺ. He said, oh Allah, Allahumma hadi ahad al-umarain. He said, oh Allah, guide one of the two Umars into the deen. Either Abu Jahl, whose name is Umar, or Umar ibn Khattab. And next day, Umar ibn Khattab came into the deen. So he made dua for one of his worst enemies and he came into the deen. Please, brothers, don't forget dua for all these people in the community of Edmonton. All the people around here. Oh Allah, bring them to the deen. Who knows how many non-Muslims came into the deen in this masjid because of brothers who made dua here. Who knows? Who knows which dua, where God accepted at what time. So make dua for all this community, make dua for all the masajid of the UK and across the world. Save the masajid, save the madaris, save the few places of worship, save the places that we've got, you know, wherever Muslims are, save the communities of Muslims and allow us to continue spread the truth and spread the good things to these people. These people are lost and they really need our duas. So don't forget, and make dua for all the politicians, the zalims as well, you know, the zalim, the oppressors. At this moment, the ones that are oppressing the Muslim world, make dua for them. This is a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. He made dua for Abu Jahl when Abu Jahl was ridiculing the Prophet ﷺ. He made dua for Abu Jahl when Abu Jahl was making names of him, was swearing at him, was abusing him, was sending Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayyib to try and to throw that whole pile of dung of the camels left over on the Prophet ﷺ when he was in sujood in front of the Kaaba. And Rasulullah ﷺ is still making dua for him. So guys, honestly, make dua for Obama, all right? That he becomes Osama, all right? Make dua for the governments of the world and all these politicians, even that Assad and Bashar, all these zalims that are across the world who are present. Say, Allah, guide them. Give them hidayah. Give them hidayah. Make their dua. Who knows if 100 million Muslims make dua or whatever, you know, Allah might accept it and guide one of these to the deen. So jazakumullah khairan, please at the end, don't forget to make dua for me as well. I'll make dua for you as well. Jazakumullah khairan, alhamdulillah.
Raqat nafsi bi nurin min fuhadi Hina ma raddattu ya rabbal imadi Wa antashat ruhi